Welcome to Accounting with Audra, and a new series focused on accounting for income taxes. Accounting for income taxes in a company's financial statements can often be quite complex. This video provides an overview of ASC 740 as well as how to account for temporary items using simple examples. To start, it's important to understand why taxable income often is quite different from book income for the majority of U.S. companies. US GAAP defines the way in which US companies recognize income and expense in their financial statements, whereas the Internal Revenue Code provides rules on how to compute taxable income on a yearly basis. US GAAP rules are designed to ensure users of financials are provided reasonable, accurate, and consistent financial information for a company. Tax rules, on the other hand, are very much driven by public policy and can vary significantly from the principles set forth under US GAAP. These differences may be permanent or temporary in nature. In other words, some of the differences are merely a matter of timing as to when a certain item of revenue or expense is recorded, making them temporary. However, when a book item of income or loss is either never taxed or never permitted to be deducted on a tax return, it creates a permanent difference in the computations of income. Let's start by understanding how temporary differences arise, and then discuss how they're recorded by using a simple example. Let's assume a company purchases a truck prior to January 1st, 2018 for $100,000. Let's also assume that in our example, the company determines under US GAAP the truck is five-year property depreciated using straight-line convention. This will result in the truck being depreciated ratably over 5 years, $20,000 a year. The Internal Revenue Code, on the other hand, under IRC Section 168, provides the option to use bonus depreciation, whereby the company may depreciate a full 50% of the asset in year one, and the remaining undepreciated asset using straight line over the remaining useful life of 4 years. In this instance, the company will get a tax deduction of $50,000 in year one and $12,500 in each of the subsequent years. Quick note, Internal Revenue Code Section 168K has been modified recently to allow for different amounts of bonus depreciation depending on the year placed in service. Please refer to the Internal Revenue Code for latest bonus depreciation amounts and limitations. If we compare the depreciation methods by year, over year, and then overall across the 5 years, we see that total depreciation at the end of the day for the asset is $100,000 for books and $100,000 for tax. The year-by-year variances even out over the life of the asset, thus making the differences temporary in nature. Next, let's look at how the various depreciation rules impact our book income and book tax calculation. If we assume this company has book income before depreciation and tax of $70,000 in year one through five, we're keeping it simple, then book income after depreciation will be the same, $50,000 a year. Assuming a statutory tax rate of 21% in each year, which is the statutory rate as of the time of this video, the total tax expense each year associated with book income should be $10,500. Using the same book income amounts, what is taxable income after depreciation? Taking into account our computed depreciation expense, taxable income in year one is only $20,000, not the $50,000 we recorded for book. But in years two through five, taxable income is actually $57,500, so it's more than what book has. The total tax liability varies each year from that which we computed using book. Even though book income varies from taxable in each year, over the five-year period, assuming there are no other differences, book income and tax income computed will be exactly the same, a total of $250,000. Differences on a year-by-year basis are merely temporary, and eventually they even out. Let's compare the tax amount computed under each set of rules year-by-year. If our income over time was the same, we should expect the same outcome with respect to total taxes. In other words, comparing a total 5 year in taxes, we get $52,500 in both instances. Since the total due over time will be the same, US GAAP designed the rules to account for income taxes in a way that ensures differences that are only temporary in nature do not result in wild swings to the effective tax rate of the company. Using basic matching principles, companies are required to book tax expense in the year to which the income is earned from a book perspective. Any amounts owed to the IRS are appropriately recorded as a liability until paid, and the differences in temporary items are recorded as deferred tax assets or deferred tax liabilities. Continuing on with our example, the journal entry in year one when total tax on book income is $10,500 and the tax amount owed to the IRS is $4,200 would be recorded as a debit to income tax of $10,500 and a credit to income tax payable of $4,200. And the difference to ensure our debits equal our credits would be a credit of $6,300. The account we record this credit to is called a deferred tax liability. We will discuss shortly why this is a liability and not an asset. Note that the $6,300 should be computed, not considered a plug. The way it is computed is by tax affecting the difference in book and tax depreciation. In this case, the net difference in depreciation is $30,000, the difference between our $50,000 for tax and $20,000 for US GAAP, multiplied by the 21% tax rate to get $6,300. In year two, when book tax expense is once again $10,500 and the amount owed to the IRS based on our taxable income is increased to $12,075, the offset in this case is a debit of $1,575. Although the deferred is a debit to balance, we still record it as a deferred tax liability. We are decreasing our deferred tax liability by reversing in small increments what was booked in year one. So instead of creating an asset, we want to unwind the original liability. Another way to look at it is, again, tax affecting the difference in depreciation amounts. Whereas in year one, tax depreciation exceeded books, in year two, book depreciation exceeds tax by $7,500. We can use a T account to get a better picture of how the liability account is established in year one and is then reversed over the course of the life of the depreciable asset, so that at the point in time when no temporary difference exists any longer, the end of 5 years, the deferred related to this difference is also reduced to zero. So how do I know whether I'm recording something as a DTA or a DTL? The determination depends on the first year in which the difference occurs. At the time we look to what the difference in a specific account generates, that's how we determine to label it appropriately. If the difference is deductible for tax and not for books in year one, it generates a deferred tax liability. I owe more taxes to the IRS in the future. If the difference is deductible for books and not for tax in year one, it generates a deferred tax asset. I will owe less to the IRS in the future compared to book income. After the initial classification, future adjustments are labeled the same, but we just debit or credit them to the extent they increase or decrease the deferred we established. If at some point the net balance of the DTA or DTL becomes the opposite, it's important to review the account to ensure entries are appropriate. Generally, an initially recorded deferred tax asset or deferred tax liability should only ever end in a zero balance, not flip to the other side of the balance sheet. What makes income tax accounting so complex is the number of differences between the tax code and US GAAP. The larger the company, the more likely the more differences. Keeping track of all these differences, especially when there are changes in tax law and or book treatment, can be very burdensome. It's important for companies to ensure deferreds are appropriately labeled as assets or liabilities, current or non-current, and ensure whether they are temporary or permanent, as this can impact the company's overall effective tax rate. In subsequent discussions, I will explain how permanent differences impact the tax rate and how using a tax basis balance sheet can help companies validate the deferred amounts. If you like Accounting with Audra, please consider subscribing to receive updates on new episode releases. As always, if you have a recommendation for an accounting concept made easy, please feel free to leave it in the comments section.